seemed like it's, you know, when your different worlds collide with each other, and then you find that it's really a nice feeling. And then you said 20 years of Fortis Mulund, and today, as I stand here wanting to talk to all of you about the work we've done with CML patients, it's actually 20 years. May 15th, 2002, I received a folder with about 22 patients who'd been on the compassionate use program for imatinib, Gleevec. And I can, you know, rattle their names off just now: Lalita Agarwal, Raghu Krishna Swami, Amit Padharia, Nishit Chandra. I mean, like, and they are now part of not just my consciousness, but their physicians. It's an incredible. It was really, like Dr. Agarwal said, it was a magic bullet when Gleevec burst upon the on the firmament of cancer therapy. It shone like a big star, and it has created the way. So I was supposed to have my presentation ready, and I made it, and I put it in a little little stick, what you call it. And of course, the stick is in the recess of some bag of mine. I just flew in yesterday from a work trip to the US to make do with my attempt at trying to bring to life these 20 years of working with patients who have to be on indefinite therapy, lifelong therapy, for a condition which was once thought to be fatal and which has been converted into a chronic, manageable condition, very much like Dr. Saab said, like diabetes. So I quickly noted down some of the points which I said, which I shouldn't miss out on anything. So this was indeed a landmark drug for chronic myeloid leukemia, the first of its kind targeted therapy. And pharma folklore goes to say that when Novartis announced this drug, the chairman of the company was Dr. Dan Vasella. And apparently there was a press conference, and he was asked, yes, this is a fabulous drug, as you're saying, but global pricing, it cost $2,000 for a month of therapy, which a patient had to take lifelong. So the question was put, how is anybody even supposed to afford this kind of treatment? And the tale, now it's like 20 years old, so I can say that the tale goes that Dr. Vasella stood up and said, you know, if any patient anywhere in the world does not have access to insurance, does not have access to reimbursement facilities, and cannot pay for the drug privately, Novartis will donate the drug. And this is exactly, just one man stood up, he had a vision, and he just said this. And every country office of this pharma company put this plan into place. And I got a call from Dr. Purvish Parikh saying that, hey, you know, Viji, I think it's time you came back to cancer. I'd taken a little break at that time. I was working for a television studio in Delhi. And then Dr. Suresh Advani also reached out and said, there's something happening. It's amazing. Why don't you come and see what you can do about it? And so that's how it all began. And at that point in time, it just seemed to be the most perfect situation you could find yourself in. You have a history of working in cancer care, you have a history of working with patients, counseling patients, and then you find yourself in a position where you can tell a patient, you need this drug? Yes, this drug is going to be given to you at no cost. We were very careful not to use the word free. At no cost to the patient, but there were people who were actually bearing the cost of this delivery system. Max Foundation came in. Many people still ask me when I say I'm with the Max Foundation, oh, Max, I see, Max Speciality. So Max was a young boy who died of chronic myeloid leukemia. He was originally from Argentina, and his parents came to North America looking for treatment options, MD Anderson, and then he was 14, and he died when he was 17. He had no siblings. They could not find a match. And the Max Foundation was established in his memory. Now, the Max Foundation sounds very grand, you know, it's like a funding agency, but it wasn't. It was just one computer on which Max's stepmother sat and identified volunteers in different parts of the world. And they were called Max Stations. And I became the Max Station from India. And it's a very long story. At some point in time, maybe you could visit the website and you will get it. But because I don't want to dwell on that now. But it was providence that all, like I said, how our worlds collide. It was providence that the Max Foundation had at some point in time reached out to Novartis because there was a young boy in Honduras who needed the drug. And Novartis had given the drug on compassionate use. And when they put the program in place, maybe the wisest thing any company could ever do was to involve a nonprofit in the actual management of the access program. I still don't like to use the word drug donation program because somehow that implies, that puts the patient at another level. And I think this whole, the whole philosophy of any access program has to be that you work for the well-being of the patient. And that's exactly what happened, in the sense that we worked with our physician partners. Even today, it could be somebody who's been on the drug for now almost 20 years, walk into the office, the Max Foundation office, and well, with a bright smile on their face, aaj hum Dr. Agarwal saab se mil ke aaye, Usha madam se mil ke aaye, and they feel the gift of life. In its total, there's so much power in that. Now it seems very easy that you've been diagnosed and you're getting this drug. You're going to get this drug for as long as your treating physician will prescribe it to you. This program, this access program, will make the drug available to you. So it seems like it's like a piece of cake, or as they say, a walk in the park. But it is not. There are very many challenges when you want to put, when you tell somebody that he or she has cancer and that he has to be on lifelong treatment for this cancer. First of all, I want to talk a little bit about the profile of our patients. Cancer doesn't, look at who it's going to, and on whose door it's going to knock on. Dr. Sabu just explained very beautifully about your immune systems. But we know that cancer can happen anywhere at any time to anybody. And so the patients come to us in a state of shock. We've been diagnosed with cancer. Why me? There's disbelief. There's denial. There's grief. There's anger. There is this sense of bargaining with some entities so that, okay, I'm going to do this and you just make sure that the cancer goes out of my life. And then eventually there is a kind of acceptance. Sometimes that acceptance is a fatal acceptance. Ye maathe pe likha hua mera takdeer hai. Sometimes that acceptance comes with complete understanding. And that's the kind of acceptance which we feel triggers all kinds of positive energies in a patient and the patient's family, so that this person can face the diagnosis of a life-altering, life-limiting, life-threatening disease. So our patients come from all walks of life. And in the Access program, more than 95% of these patients come from really challenged lower socioeconomic backgrounds. At the Max Foundation, we now manage these Access programs in more than 30-odd countries, low and middle-income countries. So that would mean Africa, Latin America, Asia Pacific, Central Asia, and of course, our region, South Asia. Now, the challenges were communication, compliance, patients need monitoring. How do we manage all this? Right in the beginning, I realized that we need to provide some kind of a safe, secure platform for these patients who have to be on therapy for the rest of their lives. And it's like the Damocles sword hanging over your head. I have cancer, I have to take this medicine, but I don't know, because every 4 months I have to go, I have to get these tests called the BCR-ABL tests. And then, so for a patient who is living in a tiny village, he has to make his way or her way all the way to a big institution in an unfamiliar city. Patient cannot travel alone, needs to have some attendant with him. If it's a small child, mother, father. If it's the mother, then there's nobody you can leave the leave your family members with. If it's a daily wage earner, then you're kind of not going to be paid for those 10 days you're going to go to collect your medicine. So these were challenges. We found that there had to be some way of making sure that we had these patients' data with us. And when I say data, I do not mean medical data. I mean their phone numbers, their addresses, family members, who is their contact person, who is their physician, when is the next visit due for the monitoring, when is the next reapproval due, where can they go and collect. So we created a system called the PATHS, Patients Tracking System. And how we, the way we have been able to harness the power of technology, of course, during lockdown, we learned even more ways in which to make technology work for us. But our system made sure that at the drop of, I mean, I press anything here and all the information that I need in order to keep one patient at his or her compliant best was there with me. Physicians became our partners. Over these 20 years, the relationship our patients have with their physicians, the relationship we have with, the, with their physicians, how we are in constant touch. No oncologist or hemato-oncologist in this country will not take a call from any member of the Max Foundation, no matter what time of the day it is, because they know that we are reaching out to them because we are keeping track of their patients who, if they miss even one dose, we've seen that happen. We've seen how non-compliance has been one of the major contributing factors to the disease progressing. And till today, it is this one drug that is available through an access program. If I tell you that it breaks my heart to see CML patients who've done so well for so many years, disease is the disease. As smart as science is, Mother Nature is always two steps ahead of us. So we have patients who are either progressing or there is a mutation, and they have to leave the comfort zone of being in the program where they have access to imatinib. The other second generation drugs or the third generation drug now, there are generics, but still, if you will look at a patient from a very modest background, one member of the family having to spend the equivalent of 8,000 to 9,000 rupees every month for the rest of his or her life, it's mind-boggling. And it has been our, how shall I put this? The commitment that the team shows, the commitment that our physicians show, their clinical coordinators, everybody, whether it is Swapnil in Tata Khargar, or it is Pinky, or it is in Parel, or it is Jitinder in PGI, or ma'am, you know, the people in Dr. Agarwal's clinic. Everybody is like, okay, we have to make sure that the patient will come, we'll get his test done, we'll get his medicine, because compliance is the only key here. It's the only key. The more we talk of compliance, and we put together a patient support group. It was a very tentative measure. This was in 2003, 2002, we started the access program 2003, because we found patients coming to us not knowing what to do. It seemed very simple, but what is this? How do we go about it? So are you telling me that my child, who is 9 years old, has a disease called chronic myeloid leukemia, and for the rest of his life, he has to take this one medicine for which we have to go and do these tests, and we have to come to the city, and we have to take this, take him here, we have to do that test, we have to pay this much for the test, and then we have to go to an outlet, we have to... Achha, ye, matlab, iski zindagi bhar, is bachche ko ye karna hai kya? So by the way, Karan Vyas is 29 years old today. He is a rifle shooting champion. And 3 days ago, he just returned from the UK, where he'd been to do a one-year course on sports psychology, and he continues to take his medicine. So this is the success story. But at that point in time, when he was so small, in fact, my presentation had a photograph of him when he was 9 years old and one when he's 29 years old. So at that point in time, there were other mothers. There was Harshad Purandare's mother. There was Sheba's mother. There was Sudipta's father. How do we look after our children? Can I send them to school? Do we have to tell them? Do we have to tell the school authorities that they have cancer? And then there were parents. Shadi karwani hai, shadi kar sakte hain kya? And then adults themselves, but I have a girlfriend. I am going to give my interview for my job. Do I have to tell them? So the only way of getting these patients to know how they could live with this disease and the treatment was to put them into groups. We really, you know, sometimes you do things, we just do things spontaneously, organically things grow. Now we have put systems into place. But at that point in time, all I wanted to do was I need somewhere where I can get all these patients together so we can talk to them. Somewhere where I can call the doctors who can come and talk to them. And we did it. We did it at Nana Nani Park in Chowpatty. We did it at Lodi Gardens in Delhi. We did it at Kabban Park in Bangalore. Victoria in Calcutta. Marina Beach in Madras. Everywhere. We just called the patients. They would come there. And at least one or two physicians would be there. And then we had our first All India meeting at the car park in Goregaon Sports Club. Dr. Sabi, you would remember. You were there for that meeting. And we had physicians who came in from all over the country, because by now everybody had a personal interest in making sure that my cancer patient today I know is going to live for as long as is possible because of this treatment. So I think the support group, which we called it Friends of Max, and managed to get it registered. Sometimes I think back and wonder, how did we even do these things? You just have to take that first step and the other steps follow. It has been more than rewarding, because we have seen, actually, we do these patient group meetings, we do art therapy workshops, drama therapy, music therapy, compliance workshops. Did a survey with the patients. What makes you compliant? What makes your adherence behaviors sadly lacking? I think first and foremost, why don't you take your medicine regularly? I forget. And this was the maximum response. Main bhool jata hoon, main bhool jati hoon. We get into this comfort zone, either that or I'm perfectly all right. There's nothing wrong with me. So we have to time and again impress upon the patient, upon the parents, upon the family members that you are feeling good today because you're taking your medication every day. You stop your medication, you're not going to be feeling this good. So, and it may sound very simple, it may sound very easy, but it doesn't work in such a simple fashion. So we started doing these patient support groups in different cities, no matter if it's a small city, a small town, wherever, aap kisi bhi shahar ka naam le lijiye, we have been there with us from those cities, whether it is Raipur, whether it is Nashik, whether it is Coimbatore or Mangalore or Kottayam, Palakkad or Chandigarh, anywhere, Bhubaneswar, Rajkot, Bikaner, any. And this became our passion. And I put together a team. And when I say I put together a team, I really want to say that the people who joined the Max Foundation, they come with a passion, with a commitment, with the sheer joy of being able to do something so effective, so result-oriented for a patient, for a cancer patient. I think in the last few years, we took to social media. We started sending text messages, SMS messages, every time a patient was due. And we started sending bulk SMS messages. And then we created WhatsApp groups. So there are WhatsApp groups for every city, for every town. the team, I think between us, we speak all the Indian languages. We speak Nepali, and two of my colleagues are learning Sinhala so that they can communicate better with the patients in Sri Lanka. Bangladesh, Pakistan, that's the region we work with, the patients we work with. Yes, the program is now closed for new patients, but there is a lot more that we are doing, making sure that they have access to information, support. And Dr. Sanyala, I have taken the liberty of putting some reading material outside. It's about the patient group. It's about what we do to support CML patients. And we brought out information. The first FAQ on CML, 50 frequently asked questions, was put together for us by Dr. Agarwal himself. And Dr. Sanyal has now volunteered to bring that book. It is like 20 years old now. So he's bringing it up to date with everything has changed. Or rather, many things have changed. So our new information booklet will have all those changes incorporated. So you see, like they say that it takes a village to bring up a child. So it takes a community like this to make sure that patients who are on lifelong therapy are able to do this. So social media, I was just talking to Dr. Kunal a little while ago about how, it's a tool. It's a tool. It's like it's a knife. With a knife, you cut an apple, and then you give it to everybody, or you use it for a more violent purpose. And it took me a long time to get the hang of social media. Today, patients who were, I cannot stand up and say and tell the world that I have cancer. Okay, हमारे घर में फिर बेटी के रिश्ते में कोई नहीं आएगा. Today they call me, अम्मा आपने हमें टैग नहीं किया, आपके फेसबुक पेज में हमने देखा नाशिक वाला मीटिंग, लेकिन आपने हमें टैग नहीं किया. Today a CML patient, and also GIST, Gleevec, GIST and CML are strange bedfellows, but imaginative worked for GIST also. So we have GIST patients and CML patients standing up and saying, I'm a patient, I'm on treatment, look at me, if I can do this, so can you. And I think that has been a very empowering feature, that they are no longer a patient, or a patient's family member is no longer afraid. I think it's all about fighting the fear. He's not afraid of the future. Yes, we have lost patients. I'm not saying we haven't. We have lost. But there has been a learning. And every time we lose a patient, which is a very rare occurrence, we know that we have equipped ourselves with enough strength, because there are so many more patients who are looking to us for that strength. I think that is, if there are any questions, I would love to. I just want to, a couple of patient stories, like Sheba was diagnosed when she was, I think, 17. She had just joined JJ Hospital as a medical student. She's been on the drug all these years. She's now a radiation, she works in a hospital in Singapore. There is Kailash, Kailash Ingle, who comes from Nanded. He was 10 when he was diagnosed. His father struggled to make sure that he could be compliant. Kailash is married, he has two children, and he works with his father in his farm. And he comes into the office, he's such a picture of joy and confidence. There are so many of these patients who've seen their children married, who've been able to play with their grandchildren, who married their girlfriends, who married their boyfriends, who explored everything the world has to offer to them. And I think if we can do this for as many families touched by cancer, we would be doing something really wonderful. I would like to, before stopping, just make mention of, I swore to myself I would never be a fundraiser. But today, I've put out something out there. It's called Chai for Cancer. It's a tool for awareness as well as for raising funds. Because let me tell you the story of Ram Babu Mahato, who's Dr. Banavalli's patient. He was a truck driver, diagnosed about 19 years ago, thrown out of his job. He's very, very erratic, very irregular. I would ask him, आप दवाई लेने आते क्यों नहीं हो? He says, आपकी दवाई तो कब की खत्म हो गई होगी. नहीं नहीं मैं लेता हूँ, मैं चार दिन में एक बार या तीन दिन में एक बार. I tell him, राम बाबू आपको रोज लेना है दवाई. Then he says, नहीं मैं लेता हूँ तो मुझे उल्टी आती है. So I tell him, डॉक्टर साहब से कहा आपने? He said, हाँ डॉक्टर साहब ने कहा दूध के साथ पी लो. So believe me, I'm sitting on my desk and I think this must have been one of the most insensitive things I've ever said. So I just tell him, Ram Babu, फिर दूध के साथ ले लो ना. And he doesn't even look up, you know, he says, Amma ji, दूध लेने का पैसा होता मैं अपने बच्चे को देता, मैं नहीं पीता. Today that child is 8 years old, Ram Babu and his wife, they come regularly because we support them. We pay for his BCRA bill tests, we pay for his going and his coming, we pay for the lodge that he has to stay in. When I say we pay for it, everybody pays for it because of Chai for Cancer. Just get people together, aye chai ka adda, and everybody donates something for that one cup of chai. So I did the first adda in my house because I was seeing patients fall off my radar and they were just not able to come. There was this lady, she says, mere sasur aur mere jeth kamate hain, mera shohar jo hai wo sabse chota hai, to inke सामने मैं कैसे हाथ फैलाऊं टिकट के पैसे के लिए. और देयर इज दिस लिटिल गर्ल, शी इज सच अ ब्राइट स्मार्ट चाइल्ड, शी कम्स फ्रॉम खड़गपुर एंड वेरी प्राउडली शी सेज खड़गपुर हैज द लॉन्गेस्ट प्लेटफॉर्म इन द वर्ल्ड एंड देन हर फादर सेज इट आल्सो हैज आईआईटी एंड आई वांट माय डॉटर टू स्टडी इन आईआईटी. सो शी कम्स एंड आई टेल हर हाउ इज स्कूल एंड देन शी हैजंट गॉन टू स्कूल फॉर 3 months बिकॉज द फादर सेज आइदर आई पे फॉर द बीसीआरए बिल और आई पे हर स्कूल फीस. So that is how we started Chai for Cancer, and today, this is the 9th year. People have Chai for Cancer addas in their homes. Hospitals have it in their OPDs. Everybody has a Chai for Cancer adda. We are not raising crores or anything. We're raising a modest amount, but that takes care of school fees. It takes care of school uniforms. It takes care of, you know, those seemingly small, insignificant needs, but once fulfilled, that keeps the patient on the track. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Any questions, anything at all? It's a big honor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Your insights have indeed given us some more food about the thought. Fortis Institute of Blood Disorders has been charting a stupendous success story and transforming lives ever since its inception. There's much more planned for the future. I now welcome Dr. Subhaprakash Sanyal, the Director of Hematology and Bone Marrow Transplant Services of Fortis Institute of Blood Disorder. He was trained from prestigious institutions like JIPMER and KEM Hospital from the country and Vancouver General Hospital, Canada. He is a Fortisian in true sense, as he has his career journey with this group for more than a decade. I welcome Dr. Sanyal to share his vision statement for the Institute of Blood Cancer in the years to come.
So, good afternoon. So Dr. Agarwal, Dr. Narayani, and my entire folks and friends and the colleagues of the Fortis Hospital. I joined Fortis Hospital 24th August 2010, the month of August only. And most of the doctors join any corporate hospital with the recommendation of some doctors. I joined with the recommendation from a medical representative. So I was chatting in my last month, in the month of July, in the KM hospital with a medical representative. His name is Shankar. He used to work in MSD at that point of time, that I need some job in Bombay. So then he told me that, why you want a job in Bombay? You are not from Bombay anyway. You'll be lost in these cities. In the Bombay, it's a vast city. And I don't have choice, ma'am, because I have to marry this young lady called Kushnuma Italia. And she told me very clearly that you can't marry, and you have to marry, you have to stay in Bombay, otherwise you can't marry me. That is a compulsion. So then Shankar told, ek kaam to karo, aap sir ek baar 40s mein chale jao Mulund ki taraf. That time Mulund and Malad same to my ear. I said, Malad, Mulund, okay, theek hai Mulund. Udhar kya hai? Udhar ek 40th hospital, udhar ek job mil sakta. I said, kisko milu ja ke? Dekhta hu main. Then I just hooked up a call with Dr. Gunesh Menon. I never seen this man. I never knew this man. He was the intensivist at Fortis Hospital. And then we just talked with him. And he told, I will make some appointment for with Dr. Narayani. Dr. Narayani that time was a medical superintendent. So I met her. I never knew how to make a corporate hospital because I have always grown up in a government hospital from Calcutta Medical College, then JIPMER, then KM. So I'm all through in the government medical colleges. So I don't know how to wear tie. I don't know how to wear a blazer and all these things. I came with a half shirt and the jeans pant and met madam. And that point of time, ultimately, I got a job in the Fortis Hospital. And you know how I came to hematology? That is very interesting. When I joined MD Pathology in the JIPMER, I was not very happy with the pathology. So I told my dad, I want to switch. I want to write exam again. Because MCQ is a cup of my tea, I can crack again. My dad told, no, you join pathology, you have to complete the pathology, and then you do whatever you want to do. Then what is the way to come to clinical side? I was desperate. Then one senior registrar from the Davangiri, he told me, there is a conference used to happen in the March-April time in the Bombay Hospital, and that meeting was organized by Dr. M.B. Agarwal. So tu ek baro meeting mein jaake dekh kya kya hota hai, udhar hematology kya bolta hai, kahe ko bolta hai. And I'm a first year junior resident in JIPMER. So you can't take leave. So I told my madam, that time Dr. Jayanti was my HOD in the JIPMER. I told her lie. My father is not well, so I have to go to Calcutta. So she granted me 6 days leave. Instead of buying a ticket for Calcutta, I take a ticket from the Chennai Dadar Express. And I came to attend a conference in 2003, 28th April. In Bombay Hospital. That is my first visit to Bombay. So I went to the meeting, and there was a lecture by Sir. He said, approach to coagulation disorder. I heard that. And after the meeting, I made one thing in my mind. Mujhe hematologist banna hai aur kuch nahi banna hai. Hematologist nahi banna hai, toh kya karna? I don't have any idea. Then I started getting how to be in clinical hematology. Then I got some situations like this. The two seats in KM Hospital. One or two seats in the Indian Institute of Medical Science and two seats in the Christian Medical College, CMC Fellow. How to be there? I told my dad, it's very difficult. Two seats, one seat, two seats. My dad told me a fantastic statement. How many person you are, man? You are only one person, right? You need only one seat. So, tum do seat leke kya karoge? Tumhare liye to bahut hai do seat. Tum ek seat hai. Try, grab it. Mate, ye to acha hai. Chalo, ek seat ke liye ladte hain. I remember my dad because he's really my mentor throughout. And today is 8th date anniversary. And that is the day I'm doing this meeting. So that is a real honor for me. And he told me, once it, get it done. Tumko man mein aaya, karke dikhao. Lado, dekhte na jo kuch hoga. So that is the way I came to in hematology and came to in Fortis. I was very well settled in Fortis. I make a lot of friends, like a family friends, I can say. It is just like a family. If some problem happens, I can call any point of time to anyone. And then COVID came. And then I have a lot of time. So then I started retrospecting. Madam always used to tell me, and madam told me the nice thing is that set the tone, there's a version 2 of the 40s. Kuch to naya karo abhi. Kuch to expansion karo. Kuch to log lo. Badao. Ye karo. Aur tum batao, ki MD Anderson mein kaun sa hematology ka treatment nahi hota hai, man hota hai, jo tumhara paas nahi hota hai. So then I started thinking about that, how to make a team. Team concept is very new to the city of the Bombay. I have some very close friend in the Delhi. I have some very close friend in the Bangalore. They are used to working as a team. I used to talk with them. I used to chat with them. They have given me some idea and everything. And then I get a bright young man. You have seen the man, how he conducted the CME today, Dr. Hamza Dalal. Hamza told me, I want to work as a team. I don't want to work as an individual. And that is the thing that we gelled very well. Because he already worked in the Bangalore, though he's a Bombay boy, but he worked in the Bangalore, so he needs the importance of the team. And then we talked to each other, and then I introduced him to madam. And then we started working as a team. So our team's age is now only 8 months. It is very new. And we start to gelling with each other very well. And honestly, our workload has grown phenomenally. Our bone marrow aspiration, bone marrow biopsy, or admissions grown phenomenally. And then what happened? We got our new drawn bone marrow transplant unit in 2021, the month of September. So our workload started. We were getting the new ideas, new challenges, and new stuff. And then when I started my bone marrow transplant program in the 2015, again in the month of August, our first patient discharged on the 22nd August, if I remember correctly. So that time, I have a tough time. I have only a stem cell separator. I have little knowledge of the apheresis. Somehow, Dr. Rajesh Sawant came from Kaukila Men, helped me a lot. And then, slowly, Dr. Lalit has joined. And Dr. Lalit is a great, great guy. He never says no to anything. If I tell him to do something, some emergency procedure like leukapheresis at night 1 o'clock, he did that. And then gradually, Alisha actually joined. And our blood bank has become tremendously strong. And nowadays, initially when we used to do stem cell collection, we used to get 2 to 3 stem cell collection. Sometimes we are not happy. Again, you have to do next. Now, dekhna hi nahi padta hai. We are collecting like 15, 16, 18. Our nurses are laughing at me. Yeah, there is. So that is the way we are getting that stem cell numbers now. And we have a fantastic cryopreservation setup Lalit has made. Abhi viability, Lalit kitna viability hai? 95% ke upar hai. Tumko dekhna hi nahi padta hai. That agony of the stem cell theek hai ki nahi hai, isse mujhe dekhna hi nahi padta hai. He made the system such a way. You all know about RBC transfusion, you know about the platelet transfusion. Now so frequently we do the WBC transfusion, what is called granulocyte transfusion. Lalit, humko kal chahiye granulocyte dena hai. Lalit make it for me. And then Alisha is a fantastic in the immunohematology group. You see the DCT report, how we revolutionized over the years, how we get the DCT reports. And then hematology is hematology, but hematology without infectious disease is zero. So we get a lovely infectious disease specialist. Unfortunately, she actually wanted to be a hematologist, but done some hematology training, and then she moved to the ID physician, Dr. Kirti Sabnis, and she make our life very easy. And I remember when she joined, after 2-3 months down the line, I called her at 3 o'clock. I was not getting her call. And I have some parallel number that I used to call her mother when I don't get her number. And ultimately, I connected like that. And I was shouted at her, why are you not picking up the call? And my wife is saying, are you talking about females at 3 o'clock at night? And that is the hot subject of ID physician. Hemoglobin, when the WBC count is 150, it's a more emergency than cardiology and the stroke thrombolysis. I always tell Sandeep in the ER that, see, febrile neutropenia, tum logo ek time rehta hai, right? Happy time bolte, 1 hour, 4 hour. Hamara koi time nahi rehta hai. Hamara 10 minutes ke andar antibiotic jana chahiye, 5 minutes ke andar antibiotic jana chahiye. It is so hot and burning subjects. So I'm extremely happy. I have a fantastic ER services. I have a fantastic ICU services. You heard about the neurohematologist, I call Dr. Sachin Bhosle is a fantastic orthopedic hematologist. Though he don't like the term, he gives me so many myelomas. His investigation threshold for the myeloma is so high that is the way actually as a team we are progressing. So it is not individual effort. And yes, when I just started my searching job in 2010, one FD of an institute told me, that you tell me what hematologists do, jo oncologist karta nahi hai. So, us din mein tham liya hai, main hematology department banaunga, that will be an institute of blood disorder. And honestly, Dr. Rahul Bhargav from Delhi inspired me to do that. And he told me very specifically, don't keep oncopa in the name of this institute. Call it a blood disorder, do it a hematology, hemato-oncology, and the BMT services, and that you replicate. That is my vision in the coming 5 to 10 years. Honestly speaking, we'll definitely number. Our strength will increase, definitely. Few of the areas, I'm very particular about that. Anemia and the thrombosis, this is my very close thing. I have to start the clinic, very specialized clinic in the coming days. And we have to forward about that more and more. Because thrombosis, I have seen very much mismanaged everywhere, has so many drugs, what to do, what not to do, when to stop the anticoagulation. It's a very complex perspective that we have to sort it out. And one of the very interesting thing I want to just share with you today, that we are just completing our 75th bone marrow transplant. We'll be discharging the patient probably Wednesday, Thursday. And fortunately, this patient is actually not my patient, I'm very honest. He's Dr. Agarwal's patient. They're from Goa, Neil Pinto. So that is the way we are moving. So I will not take much time. So I am thanking again to all. And lastly, my father is not there. I told you it's the 8th date anniversary today. My another father is there, Dr. Yazdi Italia, who came from Valsad yesterday late at night. He had a fantastic blood bank he managed in Valsad. I learned all, many blood banking stuff, blood banking requirement from him. And he always given me a lot of insights about that, how to develop the blood bank. Because other than hematology, blood bank is a very important support. And today is a very auspicious day for Parsis. My wife is a Parsi, you all know. He's called Khudat Sal, and he is the birth of the Prophet Zarathustra. So that is another important day today. And before closing, I will take 2 minutes to applaud by all the nurses. Hematology, BMT services, you can't practice with the nurses. I'm extremely happy to see Sister Shubhangi, Catherine, Asha, Aruna, and Maya all are here, and many more nurses who are working in the unit now, and we are enjoying here. So they are the strong pillar of success. And one thing I learned in my Vancouver, that nursing empowerment is extremely important thing in getting a good hematology BMT unit. And that is the area I am really working hard for that. I was talking with Madam a few days back, that nursing is the area that is very much neglected in our country. And many of our nurses drains to the different part of the world, and they're very successful nurses. So I'm really salute to nurses who are sitting here. They are not new nurses. They are working with me almost 7 years. They're still in this country, and they manage our patient day and night. They're taking all the pains. And ultimately, we have a fantastic family now. We call hematology family, and which is a part and segment of the Fortis family. And we are moving very strongly. I'm promising you it is a version 2. I will give this city a fantastic hematology institute, and this will serve a lot of patients with lot of excellent diagnosis and the standard of care management coming years, including the CAR T cell therapy, what Sat told. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for shaping the perfect vision document for all of us to follow and emulate the same. Now I request Dr. Sanya, Ms. V.G. Venkatesh, Dr. Narayani, and Dr. M.B. Agarwal to please join back on the stage. Now let's have the formal inauguration of our new department, that is Fortis Institute of Blood Disorders. May I request the delegates to please come on the stage.
Through the day, in every session, starting from me, we all talked about the one person who has influenced us in hematology. So more than starting this institute, it will give me the ultimate pleasure to request you to join the Fortis family.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Otis Mumbai cluster to propose a vote of thanks to our audience.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Gayatri. So obviously, there is no great pleasure than meeting all of you face to face after that 2 years of long hiatus of COVID and brainstorming on the issues and finding solutions that can transform lives. Our scientific session today, focusing on the recent advances in hematology, has ticked all the right boxes, and I'm sure it was an immensely successful one. And I feel very privileged and proud to propose a vote of thanks on behalf of Fortis Moulden today. So great things, they say, are generally often accomplished at the top, and today we have seen it manifest itself in the highly educative and proactive sessions with the leaders in the medical field taking the stage. I thank Dr. Narayani for always guiding us on this highly engrossing event, and this event has kind of laid the tempo for equally successful events in future. Thank you so much, ma'am, for always being there. You're truly appreciated. The wheels of the medical machinery can move ahead only if heart-pressing concerns are presented, discussed, and solved. Our team of hematology and hemato-oncologists have disseminated path-breaking hematology cases and presented them with panache. I would like to thank all the presenters and the chairpersons for the comprehensive presentation and vital case studies. Special thanks to Dr. Agarwal, sir. No word is sufficient to thank you. Thanks for your gracious presence. Thank you very much for joining us today. By sharing your experience on how to handle indefinite therapy in hematology, Ms. Viji Venkatesh, the regional head South Asia for Max Foundation, has proved that viewpoints from peers can go a long way in kindling the inquisitive temper among emerging medical aspirants. Thank you so much for joining us on such a short notice. Thank you so much, ma'am. Being globally recognized is indeed a matter of pride and prestige, and the Fortis Institute of Blood Disorder and Bone Marrow Transplant has established an exemplary benchmark in delivery and service excellence. We are indeed grateful to you, Dr. Sanyal, the Director of Hematology, Hemato-Oncology, and Bone Marrow Transplant at Fortis Mulund, for his sincerity, foresight, and giving this dream a vision of shape today. Last but not the least, I would like to thank our knowledge partners, namely Sanofi Pharma, Intas, Dr. Reddy's Lab, Natco Pharma, and Bayer Pharma for their generous support. I especially thank all my team members for working tirelessly, working very hard for putting together such a successful event. Thank you so much once again, everyone. Thank you so much for all the participation. I sign off. The lunch is waiting for all of us. Thank you so much.